So I've been making these videos for years, number of years now. And this week I've been doing some soul searching. I realize this isn't easy for me. I realize that I haven't been entirely forthcoming with everything that I know about what I'm going to call kind of the dark arts of clarinet performing. You know, a lot of clarinet performers and teachers, we all know this, these techniques, but it's just not something that we ever talk about. But I feel like it's time. It's time, and I'm ready. You know, music is, it is, when you perform it, there's articulations that come out, notes that come out, dynamics that come out, individual things. You can see them floating around in space. They don't blend together. So what you do is you do what we call the soup stir. It's a soup of this melange of music, and you mix it up. You mix it up so that it all becomes sort of one beautiful souffle of sound and musicianship. And not just these individual parts, you kind of blend them together. A more sort of advanced beginner version of the soup stir is the pendulum. Now, when the sound is coming out, sometimes it just comes out right in the front of you, right there in the front. But you have a big audience, right, and you need to spread your music out. So you wave it from place to place, and it starts to fill the whole space. There are people on the sides who've paid to come hear you, and you need to spread the music out to them. They're not going to hear anything. They're going to think, I'm watching somebody, and they look like they're playing, but I don't hear anything. Spread it. You got to spread it out. Spread it out. Once you get past some of these beginning skills, you work into these intermediate, and some of them are kind of advanced intermediate skills. And the first one is called Around the World. If you're performing, like we all do, for 2,000, 3,000, 4,000 people in these huge halls, you have to play to the rafters. Around the World, you cover the entire space with your sound. The first balcony, the second balcony, the third balcony, the fourth balcony, all those people. Music to everyone. The next couple are more personal favorites of mine. You know, we all know that there are a lot of, you know, it's a very physical skill, right, playing the clarinet or the bass clarinet. And sometimes you have to bring muscle groups in that have nothing at all to do with making music. Eyebrows, squinting are important, but one of the ones that I think is the most overlooked and one of the most effective is the shrug. Your shoulder muscles here, like I said, they don't have anything at all to do with making music, except they do. They bring tension and emotiveness into the music. And if your music is like if you're performing at like an 8 or a 9 and you want to get to 10, you bring in a shoulder. All right, and your music just immediately it ups your level one. But if you want to go to 11, you use both shoulders. If you have both shoulders up, your music has just gone to an 11. People in the back of the hall, they feel something on the back of their neck, and that's the magic of the shoulder shrug. Both shoulders or one shoulder. If you don't want to give it all away at once, you use one shoulder, but when you're ready to give it all out, you use both shoulders in the shoulder shrug. Incredibly, incredibly effective. Have you ever had a great read and you're just sounding wonderful, but as you play, you notice there's just something missing. There's something missing. We've all had this. And this is, the secret of this is, normally we're playing with our arms at our sides. And all of the resonance of our underarms, our armpits, we're capturing that sound in. It's a really selfish way to play, actually. Here, look, as I play the third of the Stravinsky 3 pieces, this is a piece that's all exuberant. It's all about giving. Yet when my arms are down, it's kind of blah. It doesn't capture the essence of jazz. Now, when I pull my elbows up, and you hear the sound just flow out of my armpits and my underarms as the resonating cavities down there, they just push the sound out to the audience. A huge, huge difference. You gotta bring the elbows up and let the sound just resonate. Resonate and flow from your underarms. Now we get into some of the more advanced techniques. These are the kinds of things that you're gonna wanna practice in a maybe in a safe room, so that you don't hurt yourself as you're perfecting these techniques. Music tends to kind of skitter around, like, you know, cats chasing after catnip all over the place. There it goes, there it goes, there it goes. And it doesn't sort of stay in one place the way you need it to when you're performing. So what you have to do is you have to kind of sweep it all with your instrument, your clarinet. You kind of sweep the music towards the middle of the stage, because otherwise it'll just kind of run out into the, you know, backstage area or into the green room or even just out of the building, and it doesn't do any good there. The audience doesn't hear it once it's left the building. So you need to constantly be aware of where the music is and just make sure it's all herded into that one place. The sound sweep is such a pivotal, important skill, but again, it's a really advanced one that you have to practice. It's kind of good if you practice it in a small room, with the door closed, of course, so that the sound does try to escape, it you can get it before it leaves, all right? So you can get a real sense of where the music is, how it tries to escape. And the second kind of odd phenomenon, pretty much unique to the clarinet, is the fact that when you play music, for some reason it's so warm and moist inside the clarinet that the music doesn't want to come out. It's comfortable in there. The only solution to this is this technique called the finger pull. Literally have to do is, once you play the music, you have to pull the phrase out of the clarinet, free those tone holes, and it just basically it creates a vacuum that sucks the music out. And so you have to occasionally just kind of vacate the clarinet so that the musical phrases that are in it can escape. Or else they'll stay inside that clarinet and never come out. Then you'll hear nothing unless you remember to pull the sound out and to create that vacuum that sucks the phrase out of the clarinet and into the world. No, I'm not. I absolutely am going to tell them this one. We talked about this. This isn't easy for me. What we call the wizard skills. They don't so much, you don't do them as much as they just kind of happen to you. The laws of physics and gravity suspend. They don't apply to you anymore once you've reached this wizard space. Like the Copland Concerto, the beginning of the Copland Concerto is so ethereal that what happens is you begin to lift off the floor. The only thing that really keeps you attached to the ground are usually the tips of your toes, and you'll find as you play that you're starting to float, that gravity has no effect on you anymore. And it becomes sometimes a scary thing, and especially if your eyes are closed, you'll wake up and you'll be like on the ceiling, and you won't know how you got there. And then as soon as the music stops, you fall immediately onto the ground. I've known dozens of clarinetists who suffered major, major crippling injuries. You know, if you're gonna practice this, it's often a good idea to tie something heavy around your ankle, but at the very least, you want to have a spotter. Because if you start floating, you're going to want them to hold on to like a pants leg or maybe not your shoe, because that might slip off, but like your ankle or something, so that you don't go so high that you wind up like seriously injuring yourself. And then the second thing, it's actually frightening. It's frightening. When you're playing the end of a phrase, the clarinet is a much lighter thing, and it'll start floating away. And if you're not paying attention, it's gone. It's gone. I lost a clarinet. That's why we wear straps, actually. People think that we wear clarinet straps to create the right sort of balance with the instrument in the two hands. Really, what it is, it's a leash. At the end of a piece in particular, you want to keep your eyes open, or it just starts floating away from you. Just make sure that you or somebody else can grab it. So, these are the techniques that I feel comfortable sharing with you today. You know, when I see a master performer, people who can combine 2, 3, 4 of these different techniques into one performance, It's like watching an Olympic event, like snowboarding or ice skating. To me, it really is what separates what I would call sort of clarinet owner-operators, clarinet players, from the true masters of the instrument. But I think what I want to leave you with, and it's most important, is that when you, as you try these yourself, please be careful. I don't want to be responsible for somebody hurting themselves or hurting someone else because they aren't really able or at an experience level to accomplish these, really, to execute these techniques safely. So please do be careful, but I really want to thank you all for watching and letting me get this sort of off my chest, and I hope to see you next time. Be safe.